Okay, so let's start talking about this idea of technology and growth and what that even means. So in your reading, in the Economy, Society, and Public Policy reading by the CORE project, you saw this graph, which is a pretty striking graph here. It shows several different countries over the past 1,000 years. It's really interesting that they've been able to find or impute data from the year 1000 for all these different countries. That's actually a legitimate field within economics. You have economic historians that try to go back and based on records from like Venetian traders and medieval merchants, they've been able to try to guess what GDP was for all of these different countries. So it's not super accurate, but it's relatively close. And so if we look here, it shows that all of these different countries and regions like Britain and Japan, Italy, China, and India were relatively stagnant from the year 1000 up until about 1600, 1700-ish. And then there was this massive explosion in GDP per capita, where for whatever mysterious reason, Britain started having wildly higher standards of living, and British subjects were well off. And then other countries and areas started following suit. And the main reason for this, according to the core reading that you had, was this idea of the technological revolution, where starting in the early 1800s, you had all sorts of new inventions like the cotton gin and other things that made it easier to process textiles, to process food, to harvest things, and farmers were able to double and triple and quadruple their yields. And because of all of this technological growth, standards of living started improving for everybody around the world. And so this is all because of kind of new developments in technology. And one interesting thing here, which again, going back to kind of the downsides of capitalism, if you notice here, Britain, they're the first ones to kind of launch off here. Meanwhile, if you look at India down here, India was a British colony for hundreds of years. And they were not able to have this massive technological revolution until like the early 1900s. That's in part because of Britain and colonialism and imperialism. They were able to extract all sorts of wealth and natural resources and labor out of India to fuel their own technological revolution. And then that left all sorts of people behind from kind of the gains in technology. So, early preview of why capitalism is not always the greatest for everybody. It's not always equitable. But this idea of creating new technologies to improve standards of living, it has tangible effects. Because as it gets faster to make stuff and do stuff, you find yourself with more time to do whatever you want. You get more leisure time. And so there's this really fascinating research article from 2008 that shows that one of the greatest reasons for kind of the growth in feminism and the growth in women's liberation was in part because of the invention of home appliances like the dishwasher and the washing machine. Because those appliances, following standard gender roles back in the early 1900s, late 1800s, women were typically responsible for washing clothes. But as soon as it became less of a manual job and you could just stick clothes in a washing machine, that opened up all sorts of avenues for women to enter the general workforce and then lead to the expansion of women's suffrage and women's rights and all of this other stuff that followed because of that. And so these economists here call these technological inventions the engines of liberation. And it's not because washing machines somehow made it easier for women to vote directly. It's because of this whole idea that as the time to produce stuff or do stuff decreases, then you have more time to pursue other avenues. If you think about like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you have kind of the base where you have to find like food and shelter and clothing. And then as you have those needs met, you can go and work towards self-actualization and other more narrow things that are more important than food. And so the development of all this technological stuff makes it a lot easier for people to pursue that. And thus, standards of living increase. This has gone on all around the world. There's this fascinating data visualization here from this website called Our World in Data. They have all sorts of neat graphs. I like this a lot because it shows, it tries to simplify this down into, imagine the world was just 100 people. So each row here would represent 100 people. So there's 100 rows going from top to bottom. And it shows kind of how much the world has changed since between 1820 and 2015 here, where the number of people living in extreme poverty back in 1820, only 6 people in the world were not living in extreme poverty in this world of 100 people. But by the time we get to 2015, only 10 people are living in extreme poverty, or 10% of the world. Education, by 2015, only 14% have not attained any education. 86% of the world has some level of basic education. 85% are able to read. 86% are vaccinated. Child mortality has dropped significantly. Only 4% of the world now dies before they turn 5. Democracy here, that has grown substantially. It's not as stark as these others, where it's about 50-50 of people living in democracies or not. But all of these things have kind of been fueled by this broader technological revolution, where there's been all sorts of developments in institutions and in economic systems and in the actual technology people use, where it kind of clears the path for all sorts of new developments. And so this is like important stuff, this new technology that we all live with. So some key vocabulary terms that I've already mentioned here that we need to pay attention to throughout the rest of the semester is this idea of systems and institutions. So I've already mentioned this idea of an economic system, which we're going to want to define here as just a method for producing stuff and distributing stuff. There are all sorts of economic systems. Capitalism is one of these economic systems. It's not the only one. There are other systems for ensuring that people produce stuff and then it gets distributed, or people produce services and then those services get distributed. So that is what an economic system is. It's just a way of getting stuff to people. Another key vocabulary term that we're going to be talking about throughout the semester here is this idea of institutions. But when you think of institutions, you often think of like a physical building. Like you have Congress is an institution. The Supreme Court is an institution. The state capitol is an institution because that's where the state governor lives, or state government lives. And those are institutions. But those are not the only institutions when we talk about it in the language of economics. With economics, institutions are much more broad. They're generally just considered the rules of a system or the rules of a game. It's not just that like you have to have a physical building for the IRS and therefore it is an institution. Any sort of norm or law or regulation or anything that kind of drives your behavior is considered an institution. Even something as simple as what happens when two people enter a doorway at the same time from opposite ends. One of them has to defer so that you can get past each other through the hallway. But depending on where you live and what the predominant culture is and kind of the predominant norms are, that determines who has to move first, who has to show deference. It could be that the older person gets priority and so they go through first and so the younger person defers. It could be a gendered thing where the man has to defer to the woman. It could be a class thing. Where if there are visible markers of poverty or wealth, then the poorer person has to defer. There's something that determines who does what in that interaction. And that something is an institution. It's this governing norm. And so it's not just like there's no office of what people do when they crash into each other in a doorway. It's just something that's in the air, but it's still an institution. It's still something that governs something else. And so when we talk about institutions here, we're talking about general rules for the system. So you can have democratic institutions, you can have autocratic institutions, you can have informal institutions, you can have all sorts of institutions that define how the economic system works here. So they're not necessarily coupled. You can have capitalism without democracy. You can have autocracy plus capitalism. You can have all sorts of combinations of these things. So that's kind of important things to keep in mind as we talk about institutions. It's not necessarily a building, it's just kind of general rules and norms for human activity. Okay, so with this, capitalism as a system of getting stuff to people has a few core institutions built into it that make it work. And so with capitalism, they're generally, according to your core reading, the economy, society, and public policy, There are three general institutions that define capitalism. And as long as you have all three of these to some degree, you can consider it a capitalist economic system. The first is private property, which is just the right to do whatever you want with the stuff that you have. It's a transfer of ownership from the government or from society or from something to you of the right to do something to whatever. So if you have land, then you own that land and it's your private property. You can do whatever you want with it. If you have a house, if you have a car, if you have a bag, if you have anything, like, that is yours and you have the right to do whatever you want with it. You can sell it to people, you can keep it. That's kind of one of these foundational things. If you don't have private property, then there's no reason to trade it to other people because it's not yours. And so this whole idea of capitalism being able or being a way to trade and move goods and services around, if you can't have a private version of that, then nobody's going to trade and move stuff around. So that's one of these core institutions here. Another core institution is this idea of markets. And again, if we think of institutions not as kind of like a building, you don't have a department of markets within the government. It's just kind of, there are rules and regulations and kind of informal requirements of what it means to make trades with people, with your private property. And those kinds of trades happen in these markets. It's not a building. You can have a market just through Craigslist and through Facebook Marketplace and through Nextdoor and through other avenues. It's just a way of trading and buying and selling with people. So any sort of way of connecting people who could benefit from your goods and services, and you can get their goods and services or their money or whatever, that's kind of this institution here. It's a method of connecting people and passing on that private property between people. The third capitalist institution that we care about, and we'll talk about specialization in a minute, the third institution we care about is this idea of firms. And this is a unique thing to capitalism, because a firm is essentially a way of having private property and engaging in market or activity without putting yourself at risk. And so, and kind of doing market transactions and doing stuff with property more efficiently and more effectively. If you made a business and you were fully liable for everything that happened in the business, it would be really hard for people to give you money to invest in whatever business you have. If you mess up and accidentally hurt somebody with your business, or if one of your employers or employees that you hire does something accidentally, then you are personally liable for it. And people, like, the law can take your house and arrest your family and do other stuff that you don't necessarily want to have happen. And so what a firm lets you do is kind of shield you, as if you're a business owner, from kind of the possible negative consequences down the road. And it kind of lets other people get involved in kind of this more amorphous person-like thing that engages in market activity. And so these firms, they are kind of the main engines of economic growth here and economic activity. So according to CORE here, they're these general organizations that are able to take labor from people and capital, which are just inputs, so either money, like investment money, or just natural resources or people's time. And so you take all of this capital and you make stuff with it and you sell it and make a profit. And so that's what these firms are here. So for capitalist institutions, it's these three things. You have private property, markets, and firms that all kind of interact with each other, and they're all nested inside each other. So the CORE book had this really neat way of visualizing this, where all of these three institutions kind of layer on top of each other. You have private property that's kind of the foundation of all of this, because that's the only way you can buy and sell stuff, is if you have the rights to it. And so if you have some sort of economic system with private property, if you think about this as kind of like a timeline, this is like very early, like family-based production. There's no markets, there's no companies. It's just kind of like you and your family on a homestead in the middle of nowhere producing your own butter and your own cheese and your own milk and your own wheat. So if you think of like Little House on the Prairie, that's kind of this world here, where it's just like private property, you're totally self-sufficient. But it's hard because you're spending all of your time doing everything possible. And so you can't really trade, if you're like super good at making milk, you can't trade that milk for other stuff. You just have to be really good at making milk and really bad at making wheat, and you're just stuck with lots of milk, and oh well, you don't get lots of wheat. And so that's kind of the world you're stuck in if you only have private property. If you layer the market institution on top of that, then you can start trading stuff. So you can have a market economy with these families interacting. And so if you think about like Little House on the Prairie, the Laurel Ingalls Wilder family was kind of in the middle of nowhere in the Dakotas, I think. I haven't read the book in years. They're somewhere in the plains. And they're fairly isolated, but every once in a while, they're able to kind of go and find neighbors and trade stuff with their neighbors. They trade actual food, like milk for eggs or milk for wheat, or they trade time. And so they say, we'll give you half this cow if you come help us build this barn. So there's this kind of this barter system for converting some sorts of inputs into other outputs from other people. And so that's this market idea. And so that works fairly well. But then once you layer this firm idea on top, then you have another layer of institutions that makes it even more efficient. So you have this idea of a capitalist economic system, where these firms, which are these companies, they all operate within the system, and they specialize in one specific thing. So instead of having the Laura Ingalls Wilder family focus on all of these different aspects, they can create like a company and then focus just on like dairy and then become a dairy farm and then trade or sell all of their milk out to other people. And then they buy whatever wheat and eggs and stuff that they need. But then they focus specifically on dairy and they can get really good at it and specialized in it. And they can kind of grow and make more profit. And then they end up having more leisure time. And more avenues for better technological change and development and growth. And so that's kind of the story here of the growth of capitalism because of these three interlocking institutions that you have: private property and markets and firms.